Welcome to Accelerated Health Radio on W4HC Radio, where you can learn to accelerate your body, mind, and spirit to reclaim the true potential that exists within you through cutting-edge wellness tools and modalities. Here's your host, Sara Banta.
Welcome to Accelerated Health Radio. I'm your host, Sara Banta. I'm a health coach, natural supplement expert, and a busy mom of three teenagers. I believe that your body does want to and is capable of rebuilding and healing itself, regardless of what chronic disease you may have. I'm here for you to answer your questions, bring you innovative and cutting-edge technologies and health solutions to empower you and your ability to reach your optimal state of health. Courtney Contos is a chef, a functional medicine certified health coach and speaker. She was raised and mentored in Chicago under her acclaimed father, Bill Contos. He was the owner of an elegant French restaurant, and she received her degree in culinary arts, opened Chef Contos Kitchen and Store in Vermont, which was featured in Food and Wine magazine as one of the best cooking schools in the world. Welcome, Courtney. How are you this morning?
I'm well. Thank you for that beautiful introduction. Happy to be here.
Well, it's such a different approach that you have coming from this world of glorifying food and the appreciation for the elegance of food, where my approach has always been, okay, what is food doing for me? Is it my addiction or is it my medicine? But I never really got into like the creative arts part of culinary and creativity. And so I'm so excited to dive into this and how you can bring those two things together. But first, I want to start with your health journey and what has brought you here.
Great. Well, I feel like I get goosebumps. I'm here on this planet right now to spread hope and enthusiasm, just like you are. And you mentioned to let people know that there is a way out of illness. Absolutely. And for 12 years, I was told by the rheumatologists, many rheumatologists, even the best ones in Boston, you know, all over, because I was really trying to find resolution. So I kept searching and searching, but I was told for 12 years that I will be in a wheelchair if I didn't take the specific drugs to treat the autoimmune condition called rheumatoid arthritis. And so I had two autoimmune conditions, Hashimoto's and rheumatoid arthritis. And I was in a lot of pain for a long time. Both my wrists like auto fuse, like I can't bend them anymore. Then one bends a little more and then the other one is just kind of, and I remember them saying, oh, you know, you have to have surgery and we'll put some metal in here. And I was like, oh gosh, that just sounded, you know, too much. So I, for one summer, I wore braces, like these hand braces, and I just went through so much pain. I remember I couldn't take laundry out of the machine, couldn't take things out of the fridge with this direct motion. Everything had to be kind of lifted out. And my wrist just fused. I didn't know that's what was happening. I just went through the pain. But 12 years of a really, really victimhood struggle of going to doctor's offices for hope where there really was no hope. Mm. I remember, I would often cry in those visits, like, hey, did they find a cure yet? You know, is there a way out of this? And it was always methotrexate, Humira, well, we'll switch to Enbrel, let's go back on prednisone. It was this dance of drugs. And you know, I was one of those kids that 16, I was protesting in front of McDonald's for GMOs when they started. And, you know, let's let the cows live healthy, pasture raised lives. And so I was always like wheatgrass and bee pollen, and taking the medicine was really hard for me. So in the process of all those years, like you mentioned, I had this beautiful cooking school in Vermont and this kitchen store. And the way I ended up getting to that point in my career was I really wanted to have a beautiful space for people to come together and where I could spread enthusiasm around food. So that was like, that's what this place was. We carried the most beautiful specialty ingredients to get people excited, like, wow, that's cool. I can't wait to get home and cook, and the best tools. And I had this cute, quaint Vermont kitchen where we'd have 10 people sitting around, and I would teach 100 classes a year. I never repeated a class. It was always something new because it was a small community, and I also wanted to push myself. And then the other reason I created this business model was because I couldn't physically, absolutely not go to any normal job. I would be calling in. I'd be that employee that like showed up late because I was in so much pain. Life was a struggle. And at my own business, you know, I could show up late. I could sit down right after I taught a class. When the customers left, no one would know I was in pain. I had a piece of shame and embarrassment. Like, maybe I'm not a good business owner, people knew I was suffering. And so I hid it from everybody. And people would see me limping and they, you know, I would brush it off. I was kind of always a cheerful business owner. I love my customers. So, I twisted something or whatever. But in the process of all those years too, my foot completely deteriorated from the rheumatoid arthritis. So that led me to not being able to walk. So my husband, woo, what a guy, carried me everywhere. If I wasn't in a wheelchair, he carried me. And I'd wake up in the middle of the night, I'd have to go to the bathroom. I would like crawl then just so that he wouldn't, you know, I wouldn't have to wake him up. But otherwise, he was like, you know, I remember if we went out to eat, okay, we have to pull right up in front of the restaurant. You know, there's no like parking and walking a couple blocks. So it was a big struggle.
So question, and there's a reason I'm asking this. You had Hashimoto's too. Obviously the pain was at the most forefront of your mind, of course. But did you have Hashimoto's at this time? Were you aware of it? Were they simultaneously, did one lead to the other? Or how did you see, because they're both autoimmune diseases. And I try to tell people, all autoimmune diseases and most chronic diseases in general start in the gut, right? Or they have the same source. And it's not that one medication is going to help your one disease with the side effects of 10 other things going on in your body, but let's just heal the source of the problem. And maybe all of the diseases, and they're all related, maybe they'll all go away at the same time. So when did the Hashimoto's begin, or when were you aware of it in this process?
I love that question. My rheumatoid arthritis started with toe pain, like the smallest, ridiculous little pain that was like the sheet, you know, just the gentle sheet was like, it was so, that toe pain led me to, you know, the podiatrist, to the primary care. And then finally my primary care said, let's run some labs. So she ran, you know, whatever she ran, a huge autoimmune panel, Lyme, you know, she just the usual kind of playing detective. And in that visit, she found both Hashimoto's and rheumatoid arthritis. So I essentially don't know which one came first. If I had to guess, it was probably Hashimoto's, you know, way before. And, you know, your listeners might know this and you know this, but these autoimmune conditions develop way before we have symptoms. You don't just walk outside and, I got rheumatoid arthritis. No. This is clearly your lifestyle, your habits, and your mindset that have created this.
And I love that you talk about mindset, which we'll get into in a minute. But same thing for me. As far as I had Hashimoto's, I was on the verge of Crohn's disease. It was a cascade of issues. And the thing that most people don't realize is that these health issues are not something to be ashamed of. And as you were talking about owning your own business and trying to hide your debilitating disease, it actually is the source of strength that brings you to be the person you're meant to be in life. I mean, look what you're doing now and how much you're helping people in a different way from where you thought you were going to be helping people just with your kitchen and store, you know, and where it began. And I love that so much. So what was the tipping point? as that you realized that your health was in your control and you didn't have to go down the usual path that most people do.
Mm-hmm. Well, my doctor, who happens to be my best friend from third grade, she's an MD and she is a functional medicine doctor, Dr. Caroline Shear. She's out in Oregon, Wildwood Functional Medicine. She saw something I had posted on Facebook. So everything is magical when it falls into place, right? You look back and you're like, okay, this was phenomenal, all these things that came together. So two things happened. Caroline had noticed that I was suffering on Facebook, something, you know, I might have posted. Not that I was ashamed of it, so I don't know what it was, I don't remember, but something caught her eye and she said, you know, what's going on? And so we started messaging, and that led to me now having hope again and going on this path with her. And then the other thing that happened, there's a chef, you might know of him, Seamus Mullen. Mm-hmm. He wrote a book called Real Food Heals. And as a chef and someone who read the New York Times food section religiously for 10, 12 years, I remember a time when Seamus was featured, chef cures rheumatoid arthritis through food and this whole story. So for about a year, I had been trying to reach him. And he's a celebrity, you know, he's just a million messages. So I never got through until my spice purveyor, therapist, now celebrity chef, good friend Lior in New York City owns La Boite Spice Company. He said, well, you know, he came up to do an event at my school and he said, why are you limping? And I said, oh, rheumatoid arthritis. He said, I have a friend. And then right away I knew who his friend was going to be. And sure enough, within 24 hours, I'm on the phone with Seamus Mullen. And we have this 2-hour conversation, which just completely filled me up with hope. And because when when you're told for 12 years something, it's in you and you almost need, which is what I want to be to people and what I am for people now, is you need that hope angel. So now I have my hope angel. I know he did this. It wasn't just some press story. I literally heard the whole story from him. And now I have my functional medicine doctor and good friend, and the first thing she said is, has anyone done a stool test? And I'm like, I have joint pain. Oh, you know, I have joint pain. Why would we do that? And then I just dove in, you know, book after book after book after podcast after what else could I learn? I couldn't stop learning. And we took a deep dive with the, there's three tests that I always have my clients do. I still do every 6 months, like a nutrition test, a really advanced food sensitivity test, and then that fantastic 3-day stool collection test from one of those advanced labs. And there's the evidence, right? Now you have mm-hmm. evidence to work on. After all these years, you're told there's nothing you can do. All of a sudden, you see pages and pages of red flags.
I love that you do the test. I want to make sure that we are able to put those in the show notes because that's something I need to do. I mean, my philosophy or what I've done in the past is just an elimination diet. I've been told I don't really have, I mean, of course I'm not eating gluten. I know I'm sensitive to dairy and the basics, and I've cut out the nightshades. I'm strictly on a ketogenic low carb diet for the most part. But I've never done an actual food sensitivity test, which would be really interesting to see if there's just these few trigger foods that I'm not aware of, or spices. I've heard you talk about even just spices that could be triggering something going on, and people think that there's nothing to spices that could be doing any, you know, anything in your gut. But so I want to talk about the mental part of it and how powerful your mindset was in healing your body. I am a true believer, as Joe Dispenza talks about, if thoughts can make you sick, then they can make you well. And I teach that to my kids. I mean, even just having how they're gonna play out their day today. And if they're having a bad morning, let's sit down and meditate and manifest what our day is gonna be like. And it can really change it around. I mean, especially in times like this when we're in quarantine, we are just going through, we were just talking about it before the show. Right now, my three kids don't know if they're going back to school or not. My guess is they're not. And so it could be really depressing, but at the same time, it's like, okay, what can we do with this time that is different than normal? And it's all about mindset, but let's talk about healing your body and the importance of mindset and getting rid of that victim mentality.
Mm-hmm. That was one of the first steps. And I think why for me, it was really important to speak with Seamus Mullen. Like for some reason, once I was able to hear that this was true, you know, not that I was like questioning the news, but I just needed to, for some reason, talk to him. That switch flipped for me because now I felt like I was just, there was a force and I went on a hero's journey. There were dark places, you know, and I had a triumphant ending and we're still on it. We always are. But for so long, I thought I just got RA. I thought I got it. This was my label. No. First and foremost, let's go out under ceremony, under the stars, and let's, the safest, simplest way, wherever you live, let's burn that diagnosis. Anything, whatever someone's called you that you're holding on to, let's burn that, let's get rid of it. And that's a little piece of information that I learned from Zach Bush, who I'm definitely a huge fan of as a human here on Earth. So yes. Burning that diagnosis, whatever you need to do to just say, no, I'm not part of that. What you have is a body that got out of balance, period. And that, then you need the tools and the expert to guide you through the process of getting it back into balance. And it can be a lonely journey going through, you know, these health, it takes time, right? It doesn't happen in 2 weeks. I'd say 3 to 6 months, you are almost becoming a completely new person if you are 100% compliant. And then it gets really pretty addictive to want to keep moving forward, but it takes time and you cannot do it alone. So you and I as health coaches, as I like to think of it as change agents, rooting for our clients and rooting, you know, I felt I had that. I had Caroline, Seamus, and I would text and I felt supported because it can be lonely. So I don't want to pretend that this is something easy. And I tend to kind of in my discovery calls with my clients almost vet them because I want them to know it's not always easy. I'm going to support them. We're going to work hard. But I don't, you know, I want to work with people that are ready to change, that are in that action or close to the action part of change.
And it's hard too, because sometimes the people closest to you, your family members, they don't know what to do. They don't know how to support you. You feel very alone and you do have to reach out. And nowadays it's much easier to find that support with YouTube and podcasts and Instagram and finding groups that you can identify with that can cheer each other on and you don't feel so alone, which is so great. And I felt the same way, but at the same time, if I hadn't gone through my journey and if you hadn't gone through your journey, you wouldn't be helping the people you're helping with such passion and such heart, and it wouldn't be coming off as so true and so honest. And people identify with that and the vulnerability and say, look, I've been there. I've been in the dark place. I know how it is to be lonely. And I know that there's a light at the end of the tunnel. And I know God or the universe is telling me that I need to work on something to get out of this victim mentality and do what I'm meant to do in this life. And you don't change. You don't change your eating habits or the way you live unless you have to, unless you're pushed. It's unless you've learned that, as you say, you start on this journey feeling a little better and then you get addicted to it. And my family laughs at me because it's always like, okay, mom, what's new? What's this new thing that we're doing? Because I always am trying to do better and biohack and incorporate something new. And a lot of times it doesn't work and sometimes it does. And those are the things I hold on to.
I feel like we're in a soup of stressors these days. And if somebody, I like to share this because if somebody told me, and you too, I would imagine, here's all the things you're going to do. And you reminded me of this when you said you're trying new things, but if someone wrote down a list of every single thing that we're supposed to do to get well in the beginning of the journey, I probably would have ran the other way. I would have been like, oh, gosh, this is just too much. But it happened as baby steps. And I had a client yesterday saying, well, what about, you know, and they're thinking of something 3-6 months down the road. I said, oh my gosh, no. We're like, we're not even there. We're right here, right now. This is the step we're at. Let's focus right here. Don't think about, you know, what's in 3 to 6 months. So we live in a soup of stressors. I don't know, everyone that's coming to me, even if they say they're well, they're still sick, because then you start to talk to people and they're like, well, I have acid. Oh, I get a migraine. No. Like, I'm sorry. That's not normal. You're not supposed to have those. Whoever right. told you that's normal, that's not normal. So what happens is tiny decisions can change your life. And, you know, I start off the day with a list. I generally have about 25 self-care, biohack, however you want to call it, things I can do to love myself, to further my journey in wellness. And my goal is always to do 5 of those. You know, just pick, let's pick off this list. Because sure, we'd all like to take a salt bath. We want to drink our collagen. We want to ground. We want to get sun in our, you know, I mean, the list is long. And so I just pick 5 of those out of that list. And I get excited and then I do them. So,
but it's a fantastic approach, because then you're not overwhelmed, but you're giving yourself some motivation and something to reach for. I love that. I want to talk about rheumatoid arthritis and the nutritional deficiencies. And how did you learn about what diet would help with your body, and explain how the nutritional deficiencies made it worse? And what I like to talk about too is not just that the food you're eating, but the food you're not eating to help heal your body.
Food is information. It's not calorie in, calorie out. It's not, it is literally information to us. It's nutrients, it's hydration, it's so many things. And as a chef for years, somebody who was also very, I trained at a Trouble Trotters restaurant in Chicago. Some people won't know that. And it was a militant, high-end, high-quality restaurant. So strawberries were flown in from the farmer. I was the first time as a chef I ever saw farmers showing up to the back door. So I became, I became a true food snob. Like, where did this come from? Where is this coffee from? You know, now, and I was like that my whole life. So I thought, I was doing everything I could. I was already eating, you know, food from the farm. But what was happening was a couple things. I was eating a lot of the same foods over and over. So I'll share this with my clients all the time. Eat a varied and diverse diet. So when I go to the grocery store, I look at what I haven't eaten lately. Mm-hmm. So I'm in the produce section. I'm like, huh, there's a turnip. You know what? I don't love them, but I love pickled turnips, and I'm going to make those. And then so I start to look around. Oh, there's Brussels sprouts just came in. Great, it's been a couple of weeks. So that I'm giving my body a varied and diverse diet. That's something that my doctor, Dr. Caroline Shear, would say over and over and over. And it actually took a while as a chef for me to really understand what she means. Because I was like, oh, I cook everything. No. You really need to keep mixing it up, because we need all sorts of different nutrients. And then you do need to figure out what your nutritional deficiencies are. I'm a firm believer that there's no cookie cutter diet for anybody, because whatever study they did, you weren't in that study. You need to be looked at as you, as a unique individual. So everything I do with my clients and the way I got well was individualized wellness, you know, an individualized plan. And so there's advanced lab testing that you can do that will identify exactly what your deficiencies are. And I take it a step further by working with a doctor. I have a team of people that I'll work with, and my doctor too. And we'll look at, I have this book here, Nutrition and Your Mind. This is an old, really interesting book. But we will look at what your oxidation rate is. Mm-hmm. So there's a Krebs cycle, how we're making energy and how fats, proteins, and carbohydrates come into our body. And we all have a different percentage of what our body wants of those three things. And so that's an individualized approach. So I was given like a macronutrient formula. And then, so I had that formula, this, you know, so much, I was a slow oxidizer to begin with. So that has a formula of a certain percentage of fats, carbohydrates, and protein. Then I knew my food sensitivities, which change all the time. I have clients say, oh, 2 years ago, I did a food sensitivity test. Well, I'm sorry, but that now that's old because I do mine once a year and it changes. Like now the things that were on it are gone.
As it changes, does it only improve or are there new sensitivities that show up later on as you've healed your body?
New ones. Yeah, new ones. Okay. And I think as you, and you probably, agree on this, but in the beginning, when you're dealing with yourself or someone that has this massive fire of inflammation, little things like food sensitivities are going to just add to this fire. You know, LED light bulbs at nighttime, blue screens, all these things just fuel the fire. So when you're working with a doctor or a health coach, you can slowly start to tame this fire. And then those food sensitivities, they don't become as important. I'm forever curious and will try to always be extra proactive. So I will continue to do those tests once a year. However, it probably isn't crucial right now because my HSCRP is incredibly low. Like I just have healthy amounts of inflammation. There's no red flags. So I can handle some of those stressors. I call that a stressor, right? A food sensitivity, it's a stressor. But we're loaded with stressors. So we could spend days, you and I mean, beauty care, we went on a walk this morning, my husband and I, every morning when we walk by people, joggers, walkers, we can smell their chemicals, you know, the clothing, the laundry soap, the deodorant, the face lotion, the shampoo. Like, I mean, we literally have are like, oh my gosh. And it lingers, you know, like for a good 15 feet. So yeah, the stressors are everywhere. But just to get back to your point, this is an interesting old read. Here we go. Where it talks about oxidation rate and psychology and how when you start to feed your body the way you as a unique individual need, people with depression, with suicide, you know, everything changes. And it's so that's really beautiful. So that's how I look at nutrition. So it's individualized and then it's a variety.
Well, I love that you touched on the non-food diet, as in the blue light and the sunlight and the EMFs and everything else that's coming into the stressors. And especially now, there's this underlying stress that everyone thinks, okay, I'm managing my stress, I'm managing my stress. But as I just mentioned, I don't know if my kids are going back to school or not. There's this overlying unknown with what we're going through right now. And I had a client call me yesterday. And she's like, I'm not eating any different. I'm carrying all of this weight around my middle. What is this from? I said, you don't realize the cortisol that's going on in your body because of this chronic underlying stress that we're all under, just as a society. We don't know what's going on or what's going to happen. And I talk about the environmental diet and your lifestyle diet. It's not just food. Last week, I was able to go to the mountains and get away for a little bit. And I was maybe on my phone an hour a day instead of all day. And my computer was turned off. And I was in the mountains hiking. And I could just feel my body rejuvenate. And I wasn't eating any different. I didn't change anything in my so-called food nutritional diet. But my body felt so much better. And I'm back on it and back into my normal routine and the little aches and pains are back. And it's a reminder of Sara, you got to get out and you've got to incorporate that natural, nutritional, natural environmental diet, in a more positive way as well on a more daily basis as I'm home and in the reality of what is going on. But it's so important. And I talk to my clients all the time about detoxing from EMFs and the blue lights and wearing the blue light glasses, especially my kids last fall or last spring as they were online for school. They're online for school and then they have to stay online for their homework. And they're like, Mom, my eyes are going blurry. I've got a headache. And they didn't change anything different. They were still working out every day and eating the same stuff. But it was just that EMFs and the Wi-Fi that they're being exposed to and not the social interactions of going into a classroom with other kids and passing kids in the hallways and that sort of thing. So this is something that we definitely need to take into account as well. And some of it's out of our control and some of it's in our control. And that's what we have to focus on. In addition to what we're eating, but it's a juggle, and it's not just one thing. There is not one magic pill for all of this. So,
the environmental stressors were a huge part of my journey, and I'm so excited to hear that it's important to you. Just to hear the word EMF, I feel like the more we can spread this knowledge, the less will be maybe sometimes looked at as like weird, because this is hands down the most toxic thing in my life.
Yes.
And it's on airplane mode always when I'm not using it. But a couple things come to mind. I thought it would be, maybe we could share some environmental approachable, realistic tips for your listeners that they
would love that.
They can simply do that are realistic. And then two, I just want to finish one thought, which I don't know if I got there, which is by working with my doctor, because this is part of giving your listeners hope, whether whatever it is they're struggling with, that there is a way out. But working with my functional medicine doctor and you know, you do the work. I do the work. Your clients do the work. We're the support people, right? The doctors are the support and the coaches are the support. But a lot of this work happens on your own. And the good news is that after, I think it was a year and a half, we tested all my markers again. We had watched the rheumatoid factor, which was 238, really high to begin with. And I was told by my rheumatologist that that number will never change. Mm. That it will always be there. Like, just don't even, like, we're not even going to ever test for it again. So my doctor and I watched that number go down and down and down and down to 14. And then it was, I think the last time we checked, it was 10. Mm. Below 12 or right around there, it doesn't exist. It's just, it's not even there anymore. And so I had just moved to another part of the country. I had done some, my usual, using my primary care as we all should for getting our standard blood work done, vitamin D, you know, Bs, and just some standard stuff. And so they did the CRP or the ANA, you know, typical autoimmune markers. And the nurse, who doesn't know me at all, calls back and to give me the results. And she says, oh, da da da, this is good. This is good. You don't have any autoimmune condition. You don't have rheumatoid arthritis. And she's just spitting this off. She has no idea who I am, what kind of journey I've been on. And I just wasn't going to get into it. You know, I pretty much hung up that call and cried, because I'll never forget someone in the Western medical field telling me, no, you don't have rheumatoid arthritis. So those numbers completely went down and now they're non-existent. And a big piece of that is, and then I had my foot rebuilt, which brings me to just a tiny side note that I hear this sometimes from people, that it's too expensive to get well. And I'm not ashamed. I was at one time maybe nervous that I had to go through this, but I went, my foot surgery was $500,000. To rebuild the foot. And I had to pay $40,000 of that upfront cash on a specific date about a year and a half ago. And how was I going to do that? I mean, most people don't have that just laying around. So my husband and I figured out ways, and it turned out it was just impossible to, with me in a wheelchair recovering from foot surgery for 6 months, to run my business. So everything was just crumbling, right? So I had the surgery. Now, the good news is I walk pain-free. I already said I was on a walk today. I have zero pain. I have this like bionic foot that you wouldn't know by looking at it, but there is so much titanium in there. It's 7 midfoot fusions. But that surgery sent me into bankruptcy. No problem. You know, actually the most successful people I know have gone bankrupt. And I'm not ashamed of that. And I bring that up because the way people are going to get healthy in the current system, if they choose to go outside of conventional medicine, is to trade money for wisdom. And we just have to kind of get clear on that, that it is going to take a little bit of an investment because your insurance might not cover some of the things you need to do. But it is so worth it. It mm-hmm. is absolutely worth it. I wouldn't trade any piece of the financial struggle for my health. I have my health. That's great. Now I can work and live a fruitful life with purpose and meaning. So I just wanted to share those. We can talk about the environmental stuff.
Yeah, no, I agree. Health is wealth. Money means nothing when you don't feel good. And it's so hard. Some people just don't get their mind around it because they don't know what it feels like to feel good and to get that glimpse of, oh, I can do better. I can feel better and I can wake up and it doesn't matter what's in the bank because you know what? It's going to be taken care of. And if you don't have the energy and the zest for life to do well, you're not going to be financially successful, right? So they are intertwined. And as soon as you have your health, that wealth is going to come, whether it's through health and relationships and wealth or financial, it's all connected. But you have nothing if you don't have your health. And that's why I'm so passionate about what I do. But it wouldn't be here. I wouldn't have that passion if I hadn't seen the dark places in life and been in the dark depths of the soil. And I always love the saying that, you know, flowers and seeds don't grow in above ground. They grow in the dark depths of the soil. And that's where the real true growth happens. And now with the way I live now, it's like the more I know, the more I want to know. And the more I realize I don't know. And it's given me vulnerability and humility and please teach me. And that's why I love doing this and talking to people like you, because I always learn selfishly. I'm doing this for myself too, not just for my clients and my audience, but let's talk about the environmental stuff because I want to make sure we get to that.
Okay, good. So something so simple, then there's no charge for the charge is everybody can somehow go outside and connect to the earth and do what's called grounding. There are some advanced ways that you can do that inside your home, which you know people can reach out to us and we can share those, whether it be a gym shoe strap or a grounding mat. But to get outside, maybe make it part of your routine first thing in the morning. I'm gonna say 40 minutes. That's gonna be a lot to people. Maybe you can do 20 minutes. Maybe you can do 10. Any amount of time of connecting to the earth, you are putting out the fire of inflammation. The word ground means return to normal. And we are electrical beings, first and foremost. Food is not keeping us alive. We're electrical beings. There's a charge that we get from the earth, from the sun, from water. So there's a couple ways you can connect to the earth. You want to be barefoot. You want to go outside, particularly a little away from your house because there can be interference. And honestly, I do teach my clients to use a meter to make sure they're not stepping on an electrical field that could have a negative impact. But you know how when you go to the ocean, you just feel so good. And you're like, why do I feel so good after the ocean and relaxed and sleepy and alive? Well, it's because you've been grounding that whole time. So to research earthing and connecting to the ground and putting out the fire of inflammation is one way. And then I love going back to EMFs. So right now I'm speaking with you and your listeners on a wired connection. So we don't have Wi-Fi in the house. My cell phone, when I want to go on it, I have an adapter that it's all connected to Ethernet. That's extreme. I appreciate everyone's rolling their eyes right now. I get it. That's fine. But what you can do is you can buy a timer, just an old-fashioned light timer, and hook your Wi-Fi up to it so that when you go to bed and when you're sleeping, you can have a Wi-Fi free zone. So it's a simple, like $6 little fix.
So you don't have to turn off your Wi-Fi.
Well, it will be on a timer. So it's going to do it automatically. So your Wi-Fi router is plugs in. So now it's going to plug into this timer and you set your timer to go off at whatever 10 at night or 11 at night and go back on at 5 in the morning. So that while you're sleeping, and of course sleeping is key, right? A dark, cool, quiet environment.
Right.
Now you can have it be Wi-Fi free and it's automatic. You never have to do anything because now it's on a timer.
Amazing. Because Wi-Fi, of course, that is something that I've been telling my husband we need to do. And he says, it's just too complicated to turn on and off the Wi-Fi every single day. So I am definitely doing this. for sure.
A little timer, you know, people use it in the old days. I feel like, why was it a thing in the old days? But, you know, people had this set routine and they'd come home and the lights would be on or whatever. When you went out, they were on, so people knew someone was home. But so that's a simple thing to do. Turn that Wi-Fi off. Of course, you know, turn your cell phone off. Never, ever, ever have this thing touching your body. When I use my cell phone, again, everyone can roll their eyes, that's fine, but I use a selfie stick. So if I'm calling my girlfriend and I'm like, I know I'm gonna be on the phone for an hour, I'm using a selfie stick so that I'm not actually touching the phone. The cell phone, the computer, the Wi-Fi, the 5G, the dirty electricity is depleting our magnesium. It is causing inflammation. It is causing stress on our body. And you don't want that. If I said to you, here, hold this, but don't worry, it's just going to like wreak havoc on your body, you'd be like, what is wrong with you? I don't want to hold that. Well, we're ignoring it, and we need to kind of wake up to the reality of that. So many people are depleted in magnesium because of high stress levels, but then the radiation also depletes magnesium. Magnesium controls all the muscles in our body, our brain. We need that muscle to function clearly. So there's lots of little things you can do, but water, I find that clients come to me and they're like, I want to eat all these vegetables and can we just start with your water? Where are you living? Let's do some research. What are you drinking? Tap water? Oh my gosh. 18 carcinogenic chemicals in the water. And again, if I said to you, hi, welcome here, have a glass of water. I only put 18 chemicals in it. We're all potential risks for cancer. Here, go have some. You'd be like, what is wrong with you? You're so rude. But we're ignoring what's happening in our water. So we've got to just take some steps back, look at our environment. Water plays a big role. And it's not just what you're drinking and cooking. It's what you're bathing in.
I am so on board with all of this that it's so funny. Have you ever heard of anyone actually read the warning label when you open that new iPhone? It says don't use it more than 30 minutes a day. And it also says don't have it one closer than an inch to your body. And so when you're holding it up to your ear, I actually feel a buzz in my ears when I have it next to my head. And with 5G coming, people don't understand that the frequency of 5G, even 4G and 3G, it's at a different speed than the frequency of our brains. And our brains are trying to keep up with it. So it's scrambling our DNA. And then you wonder why you're depressed or you're anxious or all of these things. And people that aren't prone to being anxious are becoming super anxious and they don't understand why. And then you talk about, as we go back to, is it the food? Is it the environmental diet? Is it the toxins? What is it? It can definitely be the radiation. Just think about jet lag, how you feel after getting off an airplane.
Yeah. I have a bath that I'll share with clients. And it's a formula of a recipe of a radiation bath to help pull radiation out of your body. I take it once a week because, you know, like you, we're all into this. But especially if you got off an airplane, you need to take a radiation bath. There's just so many things we can do. And I think as health coaches, we play detectives and we help people identify all these stressors slowly in a process that people are open to. And whichever they want to go, I have like an assessment, a wheel of environmental assessment. So in the very first couple calls, we'll do that assessment, figure out sleep, food, EMF, mm-hmm. What do they know about all of this? And then we can rate them and decide where we need to start.
That was my next question. And before I forget, I just want to mention too, on Accelerated Health Products, I have a product called Nuke No More that zeroes out all non-ionized radiation and ionized radiation. And you just have to go through one bottle. But I'll do extra because it will keep you zeroed out for at least a year to 2 years.
Oh my gosh.
But it's amazing. But if I get on an airplane, I will do extra. You know, I've already done my detox from radiation, but I, of course, will do it every 6 months, even though it's probably overkill, but it does zero you out. And it's super easy. Tastes like water because it's just scalar charged. It's amazing. But I want to make sure before we finish, take us through, you just mentioned what you do in the very beginning with your clients. After you go through that assessment, then take us through what you do with your clients.
Yeah, absolutely. So we start off, I have a package of 6 sessions, and that's where everyone starts. The first call, we're on 75 minutes taking a deep dive of what's the big vision, where do we need to go, how are we going to get there, and where do we start? And often, because I'm specialized in positive psychology and behavior change, you do have to at some point not be in this expert role. Every client is different, right? So I have some clients that are like, don't give me a single goal because I will never do it. I just want to learn. That's great. And then I have some clients that are like, you need to hold me accountable. I need goals every week or nothing's going to happen. So getting to know where everyone is at and then working through what their goals are and how we're going to get there. It takes some different assessments for different people. I had a client yesterday, and this is with anybody can do this. We can have some of those sessions live in my kitchen. So I have this sweet man in his 20s and new apartment, you know, wants to learn some basic skills on how to cook and eat more vegetables. Fantastic. Like, we're going to do that live in the kitchen. I'm going to like make 5 recipes, have it all organized like a cooking show. And that is for him 40 minutes of really useful time that we can record and I can send to him and he can cross-reference in the future. So it's different for everyone, but I do like to dive through those environmental inputs. And I can't emphasize that it really has to be at the working through the stages of change with people, because take heart disease as an example, one of the biggest killers in this country. These doctors are telling their patients what to eat and people are not following those guidelines. So it's just an example of you really need to dive into the psychological piece, work up from a positive angle, figure out where they are, where they want to go, and then kind of weave through that process. And it's beautiful. I really just work towards guiding people back to a healing state with food as the pharmacy, with advanced lab testing, with the environmental inputs, with the goal of establishing lifelong thriving health, right? With good intentions.
Amazing. Well, I'm so bummed we're almost out of time because we could go on forever on all of these different topics. But before I ask you my last question, where can people find you?
Great. So it's ccontos.com is my website. The letter C, just like my C here. We all in the family had beautiful. Our letters. So ccontos.com. There is a YouTube channel with a lot of environmental little quick tips that I just did 30 days of clean lifestyle tips on the YouTube. It's Courtney Contos.
Nice.
You can find me on Instagram. And any of your listeners want to talk more and ask questions, they can just reach out to me on the website. There's an apply now or there's a contact here button. And I'm here for everyone. That's my purpose. So keep supporting and giving people hope and the tools they need to thrive.
You're doing so much good work. And I know you talked about your list of 20 things that you try to do every day. What are the top 3 that you absolutely get done every single day to accelerate your body, your mind, and your spirit?
Okay. Face plunge, dry brushing, and some form of, like this right here is magnesium bicarbonate water. Normally I would take it out of the plastic, but I didn't have time. So this is, I take clean water, I remineralize it, I turn it into bubbles, and then I have a recipe for turning this into very bioavailable magnesium water. I drink 2 of those every day. So those are my top 3s.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Courtney, for being here. We're going to definitely have to have you on again. You guys have to check her website out. I love the fact that she is taking healthy food and making it creative and making it different and making it not boring. I know a lot of people think if they eat healthy, quote unquote, they have to be restrictive. And this is not the case with Courtney. So thank you again. And thank you for joining us today. And if I can help you with any of your issues, you can contact me, Sara, at sara@acceleratedhealthproducts.com. I'm happy to put together a protocol for you. I know sometimes it's hard to know where to start. And for you, those of you listening just to the audio, you now can find the video version on my YouTube channel, and Facebook, and join us live every Wednesday morning at 8 a.m. PST. You can follow me on Facebook and Instagram under Accelerated Health Products and my YouTube channel under Accelerated Health Radio. You can also find this show and all of the episodes on iHeartRadio, iTunes, Stitcher, Pandora, and whatever podcast platform you subscribe to. I also now do Accelerated Health Bites, where I do short informational videos on health topics and solutions that you ask me about. So if you have a health condition or a topic you want me to address, please let me know. And if you like what you heard today, please hit the subscribe button and share with a few friends, because people like Courtney and me need your help to get this information out there. As you share my channel, it helps me help more people like you and bring more cutting edge guests to my show. Next week's interview is with Heather from Ascent Adaptation. Oh my gosh, she has the most cutting edge technologies to optimize your health. You do not want to miss this. You can use coupon W4HC20 for 20% off site-wide at Accelerated Health Products. And thanks again for joining us today at Accelerated Health Radio, and have a great week.
Thank you, Sarah. Thanks for all your hard work.
Thank you, Courtney.
Are you wanting to optimize your physical, mental, and emotional health? Visit www.acceleratedhealthproducts.com. Accelerated Health Products to detox, reset, and rebuild your immune system naturally, and to accelerate your body, mind, and spirit with cutting-edge supplements and solutions. Get Sara Banta's personal advice on a protocol just right for you. That's www.acceleratedhealthproducts.com. Thank you for joining us today on W4HC Radio for Accelerated Health Radio with Sara Banta. Make sure to tune in every week at 11 a.m. Eastern Standard Time to uncover your highest potential through natural and innovative wellness modalities.